Cool. You hear me? Hear me okay? And everything? Yeah. Okay. Cool.
You are like 16 or 17?
I look a little bit young. Yeah, I'm actually 33.
You're actually 33?
33 years old.
My God, are you going to be happy when you're 60? You're going to look 33 when you're 60.
Yeah, I've always looked young. I still get carded, you know, it's, yeah.
So, well, were you a child prodigy or did you...
I don't know. I started doing music very young. And actually I was in love with film music from like age of 5 basically. I think it was Chariots of Fire, the theme to Chariots of Fire that I heard, and we had an old upright piano, and I went over and you know tried to figure it out. And you know, there was something about all that music that just did it for me, and I asked my mom for piano lessons. So that was the start. So I was around 5 when I guess I started, yeah.
So was your family musical or just you?
My mom was, we had a piano, which my grandmother gave us. I think it had been somewhere where no one wanted it. It was like an old, almost like player piano upright. Mm-hmm. And my mom was a musical comedy actress when she was very young. When she was a kid, she had a television show in Florida when she was like 5, Aunt Lollipop Storytime, I think it was called. Yeah.
Wow.
So it was like, so she was always into stage performance, and she's a wonderful singer, but neither played an instrument, you know, and my dad's a lawyer. So, you know, when I came, you know, asking for lessons, we just went to the school and asked, you know, can you give Nick lessons?
So, and they said yes.
Actually, they thought that, you know, I was 6 when we asked for the lessons, and they thought that was too young. So they made me wait a year, and I started when I was 7, the formal lessons, yeah. So,
Paul, is that the chair against the
is that the
thing? Are we up against?
Are we getting like a squeaking? Sorry.
Just scoot it up a little.
I think is that gone now? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Singing, just waiting for people to tell us about the squeak. It's very rare that we stop, but sound issues are always the best part of this.
Yeah.
So you started your. So did you just take to it naturally, like it was a fish out of water? Or
I loved
fish
it.
In water.
Fish in water. Yeah, I loved it. I was obsessed with music, and like I was always that kid who would you know play in like the Friday morning assembly at school. You know, that was like that was me. I played the theme from the Phantom of the Opera in assembly in second grade.
That'll get you beat up.
Yeah. Not about, I didn't get beat up for it, but but that I was you know just really into playing the piano, so I played all the time, and you know I would go to music camp in the summer, you know, and
so the idea of this being a profession was not a big leap for you when you were...
It wasn't. I mean, I always wanted to do music somehow. I don't think I knew exactly in what way necessarily. My dad, I think, always thought I was going to be a concert pianist. You know, he I think, really wanted that. But I always, I think I felt that the strictures of the pure classical piano performance life were just a little too great for me. You know, it was, I still perform a lot, and I love playing the piano, but I love writing music, and I love film, and there's a lot of different things that I've always been passionate about. So I think to just do, you know, pure classical performance as your as your life is, it's a big commitment, you know. So,
I assume you watch the competition over and over and over again.
The competition?
Yes.
With
Richard Dreyfuss and Amy Irving?
You know, actually, I haven't seen that in a long time. I was, I used to watch the Van Cliburn competitions, you know, they used to tape those on PBS, and I think I watched the 8th Van Cliburn competition, like, 1,000 times. Maybe there was one summer I just watched it over and over and over again, so, you know, but there are, there are some great piano movie. I mean, there was Shine, obviously, later, you know, there have been some very, very great, you know, music movies, but yeah, I was always just obsessed with piano, so.
So you were able to make a living as a pianist?
In various forms. I mean, I was a cocktail pianist in high school. I used to do that a bit. I played in hotels and bars.
How were you allowed in cocktail lounges?
When it was always like for fundraisers or things like that. You know, they would just have a piano and I would play. And I used to go to the Aspen Music Festival too. So in the summers, I was the the bar pianist in like a hotel in Aspen, and I was actually an organist there in the summers too. Wow. So I played the organ a little bit. So very, very, very eclectic stuff.
So now we moved into the Fabulous Baker Boys.
Yeah, exactly. That's absolutely. So I did that. But you know, writing music for film was always just a dream, and writing music in general always felt like something that, you know, it gave me a certain satisfaction that nothing else really did. And in college, interestingly, this is where things get a little divert. I was in a hip hop band in college, and that became a huge part of my life for those 4 years. So some friends of mine, we started a band called the Witness Protection Program. Mm-hmm. And it was instrumental hip hop, kind of like the Roots. It was like two rappers, live keys, drums, bass, guitar. We had a DJ, we had a conga player. So it was like this huge sort of circus on a stage, and we were trying to do it. So that was a period of time too where I focused really on getting that going, and we did really well, you know, for what we were doing. We were a big college band, and we toured in the Northeast a bit, but it didn't eventually continue.
I can see one small difference between you and the Roots.
There's a few differences, but
were you an all white rap?
We were an all white hip hop band. We were.
But you probably got booked just for that.
We loved the music. I'm a huge hip hop fan, and we were obsessed with hip hop, and we just felt it was such a powerful art form. So we wanted to be a part of it, and it was great. I mean, it was amazing performing in a hip hop band was such a great sort of counterpoint to performing as a classical pianist. You know, you got a different. Yeah, I mean, in a lot of ways, but you got a different. You really got a different feeling for what the audience performer connection was, because in classical music it's often very it's more sedate, and it's more limiting in some sense. You know, the connection you have is through this extreme quiet. You know, it's the opposite when you're performing with a band. You know, you really immediately get the direct connection of like the audience feeling your music and the power of that. So that was very inspiring, actually. You know, and I actually got even more into writing music when I was in the band, and you know, it all sort of you know, one thing led to another. So
it sounds like it's all kind of doing all kinds of things.
Yeah.
As long as they're connected to music.
Always, and just being, you know, finding, for me, it doesn't matter the genre, it doesn't matter the format, it doesn't matter, it's just being able to write music, collaborate with great people. That's always been, I think, something that I enjoyed. The band was wonderful. You know, I had the chance during college, some friends of mine were filmmakers, so they would do movies and I would score them, and, you know, short films, one friend made a feature, you know, it was all just very, very, it was really just for the excitement of trying it out and seeing what happened. And I had I still use it. I have a Korg Triton keyboard, and you know, it had all these like, you know, string sounds and, you know, instruments. And you know, I would just for hours on end, you know, sit there and record beats or whatever, you know. So I have a library of like thousands of hip hop beats that I made in college, you know, and just all the, you know, random music for things. And, you know, I even had a habit of, I love opening titles music, and I love film company logo music, you know? So I would just write like fake film company logo music all the time. Like I have like, I just, it was fun, you know? So I would write, you know, just made up like, you know, for different types of film companies, you know, I would put that together. So very eclectic, very, you know, broad range of musical background.
And were your parents thrilled when you moved from classical to hip hop? Was that
I wonder about that. I didn't talk to them that much about it. It was just all of a sudden, you know, I was like, hey, I'm coming to New York and we're playing at like CB's. You know? They're like, really? We used to play.
Did they come?
They would come actually to some of the shows. They loved it. They thought it was great. We would do, we played at Arlene's Grocery, Don Hill's, CB's. We did, where else do we play? The Lion's Den, which I think is now called Sullivan Hall. We played a lot. In Boston, we played at the Paradise. You know, so we did our thing. We were doing a lot of that New York-Boston commute. That was our...
The corridor of love.
That was the corridor. Yeah, so... but it was awesome. It was such a great experience. And I think we all learned so much through that, both about the business of music and about just creatively making things. So
how did you run into Mr. McQueen?
Good question. I had gotten to know Jeremy Kleiner, actually. through mutual friends in LA, and right after I had scored Gimme the Loot, we had found out we were going to Cannes, and I was sort of, you know, I was out somewhere, and I was talking to Jeremy, and we were talking about Gimme the Loot, and you know, he said, oh, that's interesting, you know, I have a film that is gonna have a lot of music actually in it, you know, in the world of the characters, and I'm just curious if you'd, you know, like to give some thoughts or if you have any ideas. And I said, sure, you know, send me the script, love to take a look, be awesome. So he sent the script for 12 years, and you know, I was...
Was this on the Quesset while you had this conversation?
This was what?
On the Quesset in France?
No, this was not. This was, okay. This was before. Okay. This is when Cannes was still like, we're going to Cannes, you know? Really? So he sent the script and it was incredible. And, you know, I said, you know, what could I do? How could I help in any way? And he said, well, if you have ideas, you know, put some ideas down and send over any thoughts you have on what the music could be for these characters, you know, because the main character is a violinist, etc. So put some ideas on paper and he forwarded them to Steve. And I got a call from Steve, which was just crazy.
So what do you actually put on paper? Is the idea of what kind of music a character might have, or was it actual songs? Or
I talked about the history, and I talked about, you know, the importance, I think, of getting the sound right, and about, you know, how, just what nature of sound might exist in that time, and you know, just a range of things like that. Really, just very broad level ideas, and it was amazing when Steve wanted to have a conversation. So I couldn't really believe it, actually. So, but we started talking, and you know, soon after he said, well, if you have some ideas, you know, do you wanna try to, you know, record out some ideas and think of some stuff? And I'd actually worked with an amazing, I have worked with an amazing violinist named Tim Fain, extraordinary violinist. And, you know, I called him and I said, you know, I have an interesting project, you know, I'm still trying to figure out exactly, you know, what's going on, but would you be down to sort of begin exploring the sound of an 1840s violin and just brainstorm, you know? And I started just doing a huge amount of research, and it was a combination both of reading histories and researching what was there, but I also felt it was so important to imagine the sound, you know, because I think that's something that people don't always appreciate. It's that, you know, music isn't just what's on the page, you know, it's the whole, it's every element of the experience, it's every element of the style, it's every element of the sonic character, you know, down to even the way the violinist is holding the instrument, you know? And it was a fascinating process to really, you know, try to say to ourselves, you know, what would Solomon have sounded like when he was playing the violin? You know, what music would he have been familiar with? And I think Tim did a spectacular job playing that music. So
it sounds like you were speaking Steve's language.
We had a really great artistic collaboration on it. I mean, I really he has such unbelievable instincts about what he wants and what's right for something and what's right for a scene. And it was, you know, it was really, you know, for in my life, it was certainly one of the most extraordinary artistic experiences I've ever had, you know. So what was great too was he really, you know, Steve gave me the ability to explore things too. You know, it wasn't just like, here, we need this. You know, it was actually, you know, what do you think? You know, what should this be? And then I would come back, you know, with some options. I remember once I said, oh, you know, I have like so many ideas for this, we could do some. And he was like, well, you know, bring me your best ideas. And I said, okay, absolutely, you know. But he immediately knows when something's right, you know, and that's fantastic, actually, because then you know that you can do your best work and you can do your homework, and you know that if it's right, it will, you know, it will succeed and it will work. So, so that was very satisfying.
So did you guys just record rough stuff, ideas and pieces, or did you, and then formally do it later when?
Yeah. There was a lot. There were many different stages to it, and I think the spiritual side and the song side, that was even, you know, that was much more involved as well, you know, because it's one thing to record a violin sound that's gonna, you know, be diegetic in the scene, but it's another thing to actually have actors you know, singing these songs in the fields. Mm-hmm. So that was a whole other process of actually, you know, not just writing the music, but then there was a process of, you know, the songs would get taught to the actors and then the actors would sing the songs. So there was, you know, multi-layered process there. So it was, you know, and the spirituals themselves, I mean, I can talk, you know, at length about that because that's its own, that's a whole other challenge, actually, you know, because the violin and the fiddle traditions, while folk music of that era and the folk fiddle music, you know, still there were, you know, there's still questions of exactly what would have been played where. The instrumental tradition is much more of one where there are notations. You know, you can find in the 1840s, you can find old manuscripts, you know, of the types of Virginia reels, for example, that Solomon Northup talked about in the book. You know, you can find these and get a sense of what, you know, maybe what would he have played. You know, it's still how he played it and the way it was done, still open questions. But with the spirituals, it's a whole other question because that music wasn't actually notated. There was, you know, there were no real notations of that music in the 1840s and 50s. It wasn't until actually really post-Civil War that people started formally trying to notate the music. But even there, what's so fascinating is that in the prefaces, for example, to some of those collections, they say, despite our best efforts, we can't notate this music because Western notation doesn't capture the essence of what we're hearing, you know? Mm-hmm. And we can imagine what they were hearing were African rhythms and they were hearing blues and glissando, you know, melodic glissandos and all sorts of things that, you know, this very basic, you know, like, you know, Western notation could not capture and that they didn't have the skills to notate. Mm-hmm. So with that, it was this question of then studying the whole, you know, what is available? What can we see? Lyrically, there's a lot more that you can find. You know, lyrically, there's, you know, there were people who attempted to write down some of it almost as poetry, you know, in the 19th century, even sometimes in the 18th century. But the music itself was really very much an open question. And, you know, you know, obviously had available later spirituals that had been written down and studied, but I think I always, you know, I felt a great responsibility to be aware of the fact that, you know, what's on the page isn't necessarily what was heard, you know, and realizing that and respecting the fact that there are elements that we may never actually know about how it sounded. So it was really, it was a combination of a historical research enterprise and an artistic one because necessarily I had to reimagine some of what was there, which was its own amazing experience and challenge, but an incredible one. So
how much of a span is there? I mean, is it 150 years of unrecorded or unnotated?
Well, yeah, I mean, really, well, the first, you know, I mean, the slave song traditions go back and since the first slaves who came to America, but you're going to have the first recordings themselves probably not until the 1920s, essentially, maybe 1930s, really, you know, when you had people going out in the fields and trying to record it. And, you know, what's powerful about that, though, is that you realize, you know, you can hear what it was, the descendants of slaves and people in those communities still singing these songs. But it's a question, you know, how much, you know, is that what it sounded like then? Is that what it now sounds like? Looking back, you know, we really spent a lot of time thinking about that.
I'm fascinated, though, the idea even of people going out in the 1920s recording in fields.
Absolutely.
Trying to get that.
People did, it began, and really there was a concerted effort, for example, the Lomaxes, you know, in the 1930s and 40s, there were a lot of recordings that were done, I believe on behalf of the Library of Congress, you know, there's, so there was a sort of American folklore collections that began to be put together. But, you know, there was a surge in interest then, or in the 30s really for this, which is great because we have now fantastic archival documentation and recordings of all this amazing music. But there's a period basically between sort of 1867-ish and you know, the 1920 where you have notations and you have these songs, and then the question is, you know, where were those songs sung and what did they actually sound like, and you know, how much of it when it's translated to the page is lost, you know, because there a lot of this was a folk oral tradition. So for example, I did a lot of the research focused on what was the style of the song, you know, how would it have sounded in the fields, you know, and so necessarily it would have been much sparser, you know, there's no piano in the field, you know, there's going to be a lot of influence of, there would have been, if the song wasn't sung during work, you know, there might have been percussive elements, there would have been clapping, there would have been body percussion, there might have been some instruments if it was away from the field, but in the fields, you know, when you're specifically talking about work songs, for example, you know, they clearly weren't playing any instruments because they were working, you know? Right. And so that's its own whole genre, in a sense, the work song, the music that was done specifically just to kind of get through the day. This music that actually really was there to serve a function, you know? This is music, and that was another fascinating thing that I realized in the process of the research was that, you know, throughout history, a lot of music, historically, was functional music, you know? So for example, music that was done to coordinate a task in the fields, music that was done on a ship to coordinate the movements of the sailors, you know? Funeral music, you know, music at a birth or at a wedding, church bells to tell you the time of day, you know? So all music usually had this very clear sort of task. And it's interesting that it's almost somewhat of a modern concept that most of our music today isn't really like that. It's mostly entertainment music or sort of almost wallpaper kind of music, you know? So it was interesting thinking about those things, about how music's role has changed over time. But with the work songs, you know, the song, for example, My Lord Sunshine, that's a song that the scene, we knew that in the fields, the chopping of the cane, we knew that we needed a song there. And it was a challenge to coordinate many different elements there. You know, on the one hand, the research shows that a lot of those songs would have been sort of call and response song with a leader and then the gang, you know, so someone saying something and then having people responding. It would have been necessarily very sparse music because people wouldn't have been doing very complex harmonies. And I was also afraid of doing anything that had too complicated harmonies because I think that's much more of a modern concept, you know, having progressions that change, you know.
And I think just the breathing alone would make it... Yeah. Impossible.
Make it impossible to have all these. Exactly. You're not gonna, like, your focus is on your work, you know. Yeah. And that was something that really, you know, was very important to then integrate into the music. And then the rhythm itself, you know, had to be matched to the chopping of the cane in that scene, for example. You know, so that song had all those elements to synthesize, and then lyrically, you know, what are the lyrics of that song? Like, what would be sung there? And I found all sorts of old, you know, primary source texts, and in the 1910s and 20s, there were some work song studies that were done. So I was actually able to look and try to get a sense of, like, what is the lyrical type, you know, what would they have been singing about? And for me, what felt most powerful for that scene was showing some of the link of the Bible. Mm-hmm. Which you saw, for example, in many scenes where the slaves were being taught the Bible, they were being given some religion, some religious teaching. But also, I felt it was important that, you know, this is a work song, so it's not necessarily a religious song. You know, right. This is a song about your day. This is a song that you're just singing for yourself. And so for me, I was thinking, you know, if you're there and this is what's happening to you, what do you think about? And so, for example, I was thinking, frankly, just the sun would be this ever-present thing in your life. So that's really where the My Lord Sunshine came from. You know, it's this idea of, I was imagining it was almost this, like, terrible heat, this overarching sort of eye on you that was just this overpowering sort of power. And then the lyrics were very much, you know, it's late, you know, it's hot. My Lord Sunshine, you know, just like kind of very, this sort of simplicity of it. And if you look, that's a lot of the lyrics, they weren't complicated, like you're saying, because you're trying to just get through the day, you know? So that was very, and that one, I remember Steve really, he really, you know, loved that song. And that was a very, it was a great moment, I think, when we realized that it was gonna work very well there, so.
So were there any wrong answers in the process?
It's a good question. There were many different things that we explored, you know. I think each scene, each moment of music in the movie on screen had its own thought process, you know? So there were definitely different things that worked in different places. For example, the Yarny's waltz at Judge Yarny's later in the movie, that is, that was initially, I think, going to be a quadrille. Totally different dance with somewhat similar music that I had written. But when it came time to figuring out the dance itself, we angled it more towards a waltz. So, you know, that was one where it was like, okay, got to do a waltz. You know, so changed it into a waltz, which was cool, you know. But again, I think that was really what it was. Every moment it was exploring sort of like what was right here. And that also, I think, speaks to the, you know, the element that this, you know, this is art as well as history, you know, and there's a sense of like things have to work on screen too, you know. So there are many different fiddle tunes, for example, that I could have written or that we could have selected and arranged, but you know, the ones that we chose felt, there's that feeling of when it's right for a scene and when it works with the atmosphere of the scene and the rhythm of the scene. So I think that was definitely part of the thought process too.
So how much of this, if any of it, happened on set, or how much of it happened, was it all pre-production or mostly pre-production, or?
It's a combination. It was definitely a combination. I mean, all the spiritual songs, most of them are, you know, on set. I'm writing songs and sending them down, and they're being taught to singers, you know, to actors, and then, you know, we're seeing them in the dailies, and you know, it was fascinating, you know, and talking to Steve. I mean, Steve was like at the center of every element of this, you know. So, and that's what was awesome too, is that you know, he had such clear ideas on all of these moments. You know, he even had ideas. He was even seeing things like he wanted there to be, you know, parallels between the chamber music, you know, the string players at Yarny's and the string players in the dining room scene, you know, before Solomon's poison. You know, I mean, there's so many layers that he was seeing in the film, which I was amazed by, you know, and it was, you know, it was amazing. So
were there tracks that you delivered, or were things just performed on set, or
it was a variety. Tim would record tracks, and you know, I would mix them, and then some of those would be the final ones. Some of them were there were pre-records for everything, you know. Right. So Chiwetel was, you know, practicing to the music, and by the way, he did an incredible job of he was taking violin lessons. I mean, you know, and we would coordinate with him. I mean, he learned not only how to hold it, but how to hold it in different ways for the style of the time. And you know, that's another element too that went into the fiddle tunes, because I wanted to make sure as well that it, you know, it was something that would end up looking good on screen, you know. Right. So for example, figuring out stuff that wasn't too crazy with the left hand, you know, stuff that wasn't going all over the fingerboard, because that, you know, might not have been in style, but also wouldn't visually work, you know. Right. So so he was working to pre-records that we had done, and then but you know, there's always pre-records and post and making everything sound the best and mix it right, you know. But it was a total combination, you know.
So at some point we should start dating Hans, or is that, Have you guys met?
I did meet Hans. It was awesome. It was, you know, he was always a hero of mine. So it was fantastic to meet him. And we worked totally independently. You know, I came on before and then during the shoot, really. That was my period. And basically by the time the shoot was done, my role was really finished. So I finished, you know, I did all the, you know, the on-screen elements, and then he did his gorgeous score. So, you know, but yeah, it was wonderful meeting him.
So is there anything remotely surprising to you in terms of seeing the whole thing put together?
It was very powerful finally seeing the whole thing together. I mean, I think, you know, when I was watching it and when we were working on it during the shoot, you know, it's a different experience than when you finally see that final product. And I found it even more powerful. You know, the editing is so gorgeous through the movie. I mean, Joe Walker did an unbelievable job with Steve on that, and Hans's score, I think, is gorgeous. And really, I found it to be so elegant, and the way that it captures, you know, in its restraint, what is going on throughout the film. And I think the boat sequence music is amazing. That's like, I think that's such powerful music. So I was particularly, in awe of that one.
So where do you go from here? Do you become do you start doing a polka band or?
Or I go to, I start commercials my, restart or? My, oh, I'm sorry. I think I just pulled this up. I restart my hip hop band.
Yes. When the Roots are ready to leave Jimmy Fallon, you guys can.
Yeah. Can you hear me there?
Take I think over. Can you hear him?
Did I just mess this up?
You get the up, thumbs
can
up.
Can you hear me? Yeah, it's good. Okay, cool. I mean, I think, for me, I want to keep working in music for film. I mean, that's always been the dream. So working in, I'm working on a documentary right now that focuses on Native American gangland, actually, filmed up in Minnesota with the Ojibwe. And a very amazing director that I know, Jack Riccobono, is doing that. So I'm scoring that. We're just finishing that now.
So is there a difference between the process of creating songs or moments as opposed to writing this whole score? Is it a very different animal for you?
It is. It is different. I think, it's the composition elements of it when I'm actually putting pen to paper, for example, are similar. Mm-hmm. But the process is very different. I think architecturally with a score, there's a different thought process on, for example, weaving different themes together and a sort of almost like the long game of that, Whereas with the songs, each of those was really tailored for specific moments, And actually in 12 years, I mean, there are linkages, because we consciously did have that. For example, My Lord Sunshine is in the opening scene, and then it's also in the river rafting scene. It's the same song, continues there as like a sort of refrain of that work rhythm. I think that is different in that sense, more discreet, I think, when you're writing songs than a score. Yeah. But I mean, both are very, very satisfying to work through. And I love both of them.
Well, it sounds like we're not going to end up seeing you anytime soon doing, the song over back credits for a Harvey Weinstein movie that is meant to get an Oscar. But it sounds like, the call for what you did on 12 Years a Slave, fairly limited. I mean, ultimately, people who, if you're using music post 1930 something,
sure,
20 something,
yeah,
it's recorded.
Sure. And that process, which the research elements there, aren't as necessary.
Right.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, and the thing is, for me, it was a really unique challenge because and it was a lot harder. It was a much larger task than just writing a song, which is great, and I do that a lot,
right.
But it's a rare challenge, I think. There's very few movies where you really have to do that.
Maybe you could use you on Lincoln.
Hey, exactly. Any period, yeah, exactly. I definitely don't want to be, don't want to typecast myself as, I do
it could
only,
be a series
only period,
that.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I only do period song.
You could do the History Channel right after exactly. Mythbusters.
I'll help you figure out, music of 1550, what is that,
We can get you a funny hat, the whole thing. I think it's a big hit show already.
Yeah, hey, look, I'm open to interesting ideas.
Well, I mean, do you cut into traditional scores? Are you,
Yeah.
Do you want to be like Jerry Goldsmith when you grow up, or do you want to?
Jerry Goldsmith's awesome. I love films. I mean, I would, I think my dream would, definitely my dream is to be involved in films of any sort. Being able to do that, I think, is sort of a dream.
So what is it about film?
Yeah. For me, it's a combination of things, I think. One thing, as a composer, film is today, I think, one of the best ways to actually get your music heard by people, and I've always felt that, coming from a classical background too, it's one thing to have a small audience somewhere hear your music and, you feel that sense of camaraderie and communication. But I think, when I write a song for a movie or when I write a score for a film, potentially thousands, hundreds of thousands of people may hear it, literally, which is, and there's a level of, there's a joy from that, because I do think, I guess a lot of different composers have different feelings on why they write music, but I definitely write music because I think trying to communicate emotions with people, that I'm feeling, and it's a way of having that happen. So, the more people you can do that with is amazing, and film is absolutely, I think, one of, if not the best way, especially for someone who has orchestral and instrumental experience, you know, with that music. The other thing is I just love movies. So, you know, I've just loved movies forever. And, you know, there's definitely a special moment when you write something and you see it on screen and you see what it does to the picture. You know, it adds a dimension that is sort of indescribable, I think. And it's much cooler than just hearing, for me, it's much cooler than just hearing the music. You know, when you see it there, there's a power to that. And I think that's what's always been so attractive in a way. Yeah.
Though so. It sounds like you're not one to say, okay, play the first two notes of the score. Oh, that's his score. It sounds like you have a sense of eclecticism and wanting to.
Yeah, I think there is. I've found over time, like, I've never tried to have a specific sound, you know. Mm-hmm. And I love so many genres of music. I've never, I feel it's all music, you know, and they're all just different ways of saying things, you know. Mm-hmm. But I do find now that, like, when I look back at the music I write, I think there are certain, you know, there are certain I think you can't help it. You know, there are certain traits you have that are innate, sort of unconscious musical traits that you imbue into what you do, you know, almost like your way of speaking. You know, it's that same kind of thing. But I do love the challenge of writing in different styles, and I do love the challenge of different film projects and those, you know, the facing that task of, you know, well, we have this issue, how do we figure this out? Or this movie is set in space, or this movie is set in the 1840s. You know, I love that. And I think it's a great way of bringing to bear sort of everything you know about music and applying it to a particular issue or problem. So.
And by the time you're 40, we'll just be able to nail you. Anything you do,
you'll be like, oh, that's obviously Nick. I mean, it's clearly it's his signature fiddle sound or something. Yeah, you know, but yeah, no, I've found that. I always wondered too, you know, because you look at composers and they, you know, by and large, composers do have a voice, they have a sound, and I always wondered. I was like, what is my sound? You know, how do I find it? And I think the thing is, you sort of don't ask that question. You know, it's like your sound is just what you end up making. And it's almost like that signature is something that it's not really for you to see because you're like so in it, you know. So it's only visible, I think, in hindsight.
Like Harvey the Rabbit.
It's this like, yeah, you see it and it's, oh, I guess that was what I did. Okay, you know.
If you're thinking, you're not doing it.
Exactly. And that's true for so many things. I used to find that in performing piano too. That was an interesting thing, like the psychology of that. You know, it's like when you're performing, you can't think about that you're performing because then you're not performing. You're, you know, and it's that focus and distraction question, you know. So you just sort of do it. You know, it's sort of zen, and then you step back and you did it. So there's some of that.